Hello again, everyone. If the energy transition is successful and we develop a lot of renewable energy, this will pose some serious challenges to the way the market works. I don't have all the answers, but we'll try to give you some food for thought. Here you see an example of a future neighborhood that produces a lot of its own energy with solar and wind power. The red line presents the neighborhood's electricity demand during 5 days. The highest peaks are the early evenings when households are busiest. The lower peaks are the mornings. The blue area represents wind generation, and the yellow area is solar generation. The difference between local demand, the red line, and local generation is the gray area. This is energy that the neighborhood needs to obtain from the power grid. Currently, this electricity from the grid is mainly generated from fossil fuels, but in the future, this may become renewable as well. We see that the neighborhood can produce much of its own electricity with solar and wind energy, but not all. Installing more solar and wind capacity will not fix the problem, because there are times when neither is sufficiently available. On the other hand, there are also hours when the neighborhood produces more electricity than it needs. This, in a nutshell, is the challenge posed by solar and wind energy, which happen to be two of the most abundant and affordable sources of renewable energy. How can we deal with this mismatch between supply and demand? Let's look at the electricity value chain. The challenge is posed by the development of intermittent renewable energy sources. It does not matter whether they are near the consumer or farther away. There are four types of solutions. First, thermal generators can produce the flexibility to fill the gap between solar and wind output and electricity demand. As a transition measure, we may capture the CO2 emissions of coal and gas plants and store them underground. This is expensive, however, and in the end not sustainable because it continues to make use of fossil fuels. Moreover, capturing and storing CO2 costs a lot of energy itself. Biomass generators are a renewable energy technology that is controllable. Their operating costs are higher because of the cost of the fuel, but their value is also higher because they are controllable. Aside from flexible generation, a second option is to store electric energy. We saw that there will be times when the output of solar and wind generators is higher than demand. If we can store these surpluses in an economic way, this would greatly facilitate the transition to a sustainable energy system. Current storage technologies, however, do not recover their costs in the market. So here is an important research challenge. A third option is to strengthen the electricity grid. By spreading the variations in demand and the fluctuations in renewable energy generation over a larger area, they will be dampened. This is currently a cheaper option for dealing with intermittent renewable energy sources. Finally, the demand for electricity may become more flexible. Companies may adjust their production schedules, and consumers may also show some flexibility, for instance, when charging electric vehicles. This is called demand response. This is a cheap solution as well, but it requires that consumers receive some kind of signal and a reward for being flexible. This is an important reason for developing smart grids. Neither flexible consumption nor network expansion will fully solve the challenge. There will always be periods of days or weeks when there is not enough solar and wind energy to meet demand. This is where storage and flexible generation come in the picture, even if they are more expensive. So, taking all of this together, we will need a combination of innovative, clean, and flexible generation sources, affordable storage technology, increased network capacity, and optimal use of consumer flexibility. What does this mean for the design of the electricity market? An increasing share of renewables affects the merit order and the market price quite substantially. I'll show you how. Let's return to the supply function. We start with an hour with little wind and solar energy. The power plants are dispatched according to their price bids. In this example, the market price is 50 euros per megawatt hour. Now imagine a very windy day, so the wind generators run at full capacity. The price bids remain the same, so there's no change in the merit order. But the supply curve is shifted to the right due to the additional capacity offered by the wind generators. Let's assume the demand remains the same. then the market price will be substantially lower, namely 25 euros per megawatt hour in this example. What does this mean for the market? There are two main consequences. Firstly, the operating profit of all market parties decreases. This means that less income can be used to cover investments. Secondly, the more expensive plants do not run anymore during this hour. With respect to our climate policy goals, this is what we want because these are probably fossil fuel generators. However, in the coming years, we need these fossil generators to provide energy when there's not enough renewable energy to meet demand. If they run fewer and fewer hours, how will they cover their costs? With high shares of wind and solar power, there'll be increasingly many hours during which there is more supply than demand, and the electricity price becomes very low. This makes it more and more difficult for controllable thermal generators to recover their cost in the market. This problem will continue to exist even in a fully renewable electricity system, as then, too, there need to be controllable generators, such as biomass plants and/or storage facilities. They will need to be ready to meet demand when it is higher than solar and wind output, which means that their installed capacity must be about equal to peak demand, while they may not operate very many hours per year. A solution is not only to pay generators for the energy that they deliver, but also for the service of being available. After all, this is what we expect. We want them to be there when demand is high and solar and wind output are low. Capacity markets do this. They reward generators for being available. They are common in North and South America and in some European countries as well. But wait, do we want another policy intervention in the electricity market? Let's step back for a moment. We started by saying that we need renewable energy policies, CO2 policy, and a range of energy efficiency policies. In addition, the way in which the power balance on the grid is maintained and the rules of the power exchange affect the development of renewable energy. The integration of solar and wind energy in the system is also strongly affected by the way in which network congestion is handled. This is usually done differently within countries and on country borders. Now, we're also talking about capacity markets in order to maintain resource adequacy. So you see that the concept of a free market is being buried underneath a whole pile of policy instruments and market design choices. To make it more complicated, all of these issues are usually implemented differently in each country. Step across any country border in Europe, and the same set of policies is implemented in a different way. And even worse, many of these design choices and policy instruments influence each other. The result is a highly complex market design. Will this set of policy instruments and market design choices lead the market in the right direction? European energy companies are performing poorly in financial terms, and investors are uncertain. In order to convince investors to make the large, innovative investments that we need to get to a renewable energy system, it appears that they need more security than our short-term markets can provide. For instance, in the form of long-term contracts. A simpler, more transparent market design would also help. But it is not clear which market design would work in the long run. And at the same time, market parties crave regulatory stability. We are at the end of the block on electricity markets and regulation. We learned how markets can work and why they fail to reach a social optimum in case of pollution like CO2. We reviewed a number of policy options for making the electricity sector more sustainable, instruments for stimulating renewable energy, the European CO2 emission trade system, and energy efficiency policies. However, this leads to a pancaking of policy instruments on top of an already complex electricity market design. A lack of transparency and regulatory uncertainty result. What we do know is that the increasing use of intermittent renewable energy sources creates a need for more flexibility in the system. This can be in the form of generation, storage, network capacity, and consumer flexibility. Without enough flexibility, prices will become more variable. It is a question whether the current market design, with its complexity and focus on short-term prices, is the best in the long run. Perhaps there is a larger role for long-term contracts in the future, even though spot prices will remain necessary for signaling current conditions. Thank you for taking this course. I hope it will help you contribute to a cleaner energy sector.